shooting.
Bill Goldman, it is such a rarity that we have a chance to speak with you.
Yes, it's been 10 years, hasn't it?
Yes, that makes it rare. But I thank you for participating in this.
Pleasure.
The Ghost and the Darkness, and you wrote the screenplay. Mm-hmm. Now, let me go back. Was it originally a book? Is it based on a book?
It's obviously, it's a true story. The man Patterson, who was the engineer who eventually kills them, wrote a book about it. There are also several books that are written about it, about the building of the railroad, because, and then also this incident, there, very briefly, there's a book published last year by an Oxford historian called Millennium, about the last 100 years on Earth. It's a 700-page book. Two of those pages are about the Lions of Savo. He thinks what they are is the great blazing symbol of nature saying to man, stop this. I think they're evil. It's a famous story. It's been picked up a lot of places. It just never, for whatever reason, I don't understand, Hollywood has never done it before. I don't know why. Maybe 20 years ago they couldn't do it technically. I have no idea, but it's happened now, and I like the movie, which is why I'm here.
But there's no explanation for why the lions were so evil. There
no.
were two of them.
Well, there are two lions. There's no explanation that anyone's come up with because it's a unique incident. Never happened before, never happened since to anybody's knowledge. So people are trying to put, people have always tried to say, well, I'll explain why it happened. It happened because of A, B, or C. The fact is we don't know. The fact is this incident is a total aberration. It's not the way animals behave. These guys did it. They killed 135 people. Why? Nobody knows. That cave sequence is really spooky when you see all those bones and all that bracelets. Why did they do that? Don't know why they did that. They killed for pleasure. Doesn't happen.
And the cave really happened.
Oh, yeah, it all really happened. I messed around with the people because that's I'm free to do that because the people are what essentially, I can have them say whatever I want. I didn't mess around. Everything with the lions happened as such. I mean, when Patterson's about to shoot one and he turns to get the gun from his friend and the guy has run, that happened. When the railroad car scene, when they missed, happened. It all happened. It's an amazing thing. One of the problems with the movie has been getting people to believe that it happened because we're from Hollywood and we lie and cheat and steal and change things and exaggerate. This I didn't exaggerate with the lions here. I mean, that hospital sequence is, read the book. It's just, they destroyed it. They did that. They just ripped it apart, tore the tents down. Why'd they do that? I don't know. What were they angry at? I mean, why were they killing? Why were they, and it's a great, for me, still, I've come across the two, the Butch Cassidy story and this, are the two stories I find continually fascinating, and I don't know why. I just love them.
You're responsible, though, for the movie being made, are you not? Aren't you?
Well, the real people, Paramount gave us a lot of money to make the movie, so they're really responsible. Yeah, I mean, ultimately, the screenplay was the springboard for the film. I mean, a lot of people have, I came across the idea in 84, I wrote it in 89, and it's now 96, so it's been through a lot of lives. The people at Paramount now, Sherry Lansing and her people, always liked the screenplay. They simply were not in a position of power, and then ultimately, Michael Douglas came in to produce, and then later to star, and then we got Val Kilmer, who was hot, and Paramount said go, so all of a sudden we are here. But I mean, ultimately, yeah, the springboard, the screenplay is usually everything to get a movie going. If there's a problem in the screenplay, it's going to haunt you. If you don't fix it early on, guess what? When you get the movie up there, the hole's going to be there. So you better try and make it work. You better try and make it work when you have the time to make the script hold. Because there's no time. Once you gear into production, there are just a million other problems, and you have no time to try and fix things.
Were you on the set a lot?
I don't like, I was there twice. I don't like to go. I'm just, it's always been something. I wrote this line years ago. I said, the most exciting day of your life is the first day on a movie set, and the most boring day of your life is every day thereafter. Unless you have a real job on the set, when you have nothing to do, you've been on sets, you know, you're just sitting and sitting and sitting and sitting and sitting while the lights are changed, or while the actor has makeup, or while it's just an endless bore.
And then they
do, and then they do it over and over and over. And you know, it's one of those things. It's just endless. It's just, it's a thing. I usually, because movies are like a relay race, I'm usually first. The composer is usually last. I mean, I met Jerry Goldsmith on this movie, who did the score. I think Jerry may be the first composer I ever met on a film. Because movies take so long that very often by the time a composer is hired, it's a year after I'm gone. I mean, it's a strange heffalump, a movie, the making of a movie.
Well, this one turned out very, very well, and
I hope
it does well.
Thank you, Mike.
Bill, again, thank you so much for participating.
My pleasure.
We just don't see you often enough.
Thank you, dear.
Thank you.
Were you spooked?
Bill Goldman, it is such a rarity that we have a chance to speak with you.
Yes, and it's been 10 years, hasn't it?
Yes, that makes it rare. But thank you for participating in
My
this.
Pleasure.
The Ghost and the Darkness, and you wrote the screenplay. Mm-hmm. Now, let me go back. Was it originally a book? Is it based on a book?
It's obviously a true story. The man Patterson, who was the engineer who eventually kills them, wrote a book about it. There are also several books that are written about it, about the building of the railroad, and then also this incident, very briefly, there's a book published last year by an Oxford historian called Millennium about the last 100 years on Earth. It's a 700-page book. Two of those pages are about the Lions of Savo. He thinks what they are is the great blazing symbol of nature saying to man, stop this. I think they're evil. It's a famous story. It's been picked up a lot of places. It just never, for whatever reason, I don't understand, Hollywood has never done it before. I don't know why. Maybe 20 years ago they couldn't do it technically. I have no idea, but it's happened now, and I like the movie, which is why I'm here.
But there's no explanation for why the lions were so evil. There
No.
were two of them.
Well, there are two lions. There's no explanation that anyone's come up with because it's a unique incident. Never happened before, never happened since to anybody's knowledge. So people are trying to put, people have always tried to say, well, I'll explain why it happened. It happened because of A, B, or C. The fact is we don't know. The fact is this incident is a total aberration. It's not the way animals behave. These guys did it. They killed 135 people. Why? Nobody knows. That cave sequence is really spooky when you see all those bones and all that bracelets. Why did they do that? Don't know why they did that. They killed for pleasure. Doesn't happen.
And the cave really happened.
Oh, yeah, it all really happened. I messed around with the people because I'm free to do that because the people are what essentially, I can have them say whatever I want. I didn't mess around. Everything with the lions happened as such. I mean, when Patterson's about to shoot one and he turns to get the gun from his friend and the guy has run, that happened. When the railroad car scene, when they missed, happened. It all happened. It's an amazing thing. One of the problems with the movie has been getting people to believe that it happened because we're from Hollywood and we lie and cheat and steal and change things and exaggerate. I didn't exaggerate with the lions here. I mean, that hospital sequence is, read the book. It's just, they destroyed it. They did that. They just ripped it apart, tore the tents down. Why'd they do that? I don't know. What were they angry at? I mean, why were they killing? Why were they eating? For me, still, I've come across the two. The Butch Cassidy story and this are the two stories I find continually fascinating, and I don't know why. I just love them.
You're responsible, though, for the movie being made, are you not? Aren't you?
Well,
Paramount
gave us a lot of money to make the movie, so they're really responsible. Yeah, I mean, ultimately, the screenplay was the springboard for the film. I mean, a lot of people I came across the idea in 84, I wrote it in 89, and it's now 96, so it's been through a lot of lives. The people at Paramount now, Sherry Lansing and her people, always liked the screenplay. They simply were not in a position of power, and then ultimately, Michael Douglas came in to produce, and then later to star, and then we got Val Kilmer, who was hot, and Paramount said go, so all of a sudden we are here. But I mean, ultimately, yeah, the springboard, the screenplay is usually everything to get a movie going. If there's a problem in the screenplay, it's going to haunt you. If you don't fix it early on, guess what? When you get the movie up there, the hole's going to be there. So you better try and make it work. You better try and make it work when you have the time to make the script hold. Because there's no time. Once you gear into production, there are just a million other problems, and you have no time to try and fix things.
Were you on the set a lot?
I was there twice. I don't like to go. It's always been something. I wrote this line years ago. I said, the most exciting day of your life is the first day on a movie set, and the most boring day of your life is every day thereafter. Unless you have a real job on the set, when you have nothing to do, you've been on sets, you know, you're just sitting and sitting and sitting and sitting and sitting while the lights are changed, or while the actor has makeup, or while it's just an endless bore.
And then they do, agree with you
and
more.
Then they do it over and over and over. And you know, it's one of those things. It's just endless. It's just, it's a thing. I usually, because movies are like a relay race, I'm usually first. The composer is usually last. I mean, I met Jerry Goldsmith on this movie, who did the score. I think Jerry may be the first composer I ever met on a film. Movies take so long that very often by the time a composer is hired, it's a year after I'm gone. I mean, it's a strange heffalump, the making of a movie.
Well, this one turned out very, very well, and
thank
I
you.
Hope it does well.
Thank you, Mike.
Bill, again, thank you so much for participating.
My pleasure.
We just don't see you often enough.
Thank you, dear.
Thank you.
Did you...